morning, everybody. It's a pleasure to be here. Thank you for joining us all. My name is Matt McDonough. I'm the Plymouth County Register of Probate, and part of my responsibilities today are to be your MC. And I want to extend, first and foremost, our gratitude to our sponsors today, Family and Community Resources, and my good friend Pat Kelleher, who reached out to me and recruited me today. Let's have a round of applause for FCR. And also, we want to extend our thanks to the Massasoit Women's Center, who so graciously sponsored and financed this event and gave us a great breakfast today. So let's have a round of applause for the Women's Center. So we're here today for the White Ribbon Day campaign. And I want to give a little bit of history about the campaign and then introduce some of the elected officials and dignitaries who joined us here today. Taking the Massachusetts White Ribbon Day pledge is about several things. Making a personal commitment to ending men's violence against women and all gender-based violence, promoting respect, dignity, and equality, speaking out against attitudes and behaviors that contribute to sexual assault, domestic violence, stalking, sexual harassment, and human trafficking, realizing that gender violence is a men's issue that affects all of us, confronting sexism, homophobia, racism, and other forms of oppression, finding out how to help someone who may be a victim or offender of sexual assault or domestic violence. It's a wonderful awareness campaign that has a history going back to 1991, where it was a reaction to one man's massacre of 14 female college students in Montreal, specifically because they were women. This effort has mobilized boys and men around the world to take a stand against violence against women. The Massachusetts White Ribbon Day campaign is an annual day of recognition of the role that men can play in stopping domestic violence against women and all gender-based violence. Today, we're going to take a pledge, the White Ribbon Day pledge. We're going to take it together to make a commitment to be part of the solution in ending this violence. We will all wear our white ribbons, as many of us already have in our lapels today, as a sign of our commitment. Taking the pledge means not only promising never to be a perpetrator of violence against women, but also promising never to be a silent bystander, and to get help when you suspect someone is a victim or offender of sexual assault or domestic violence. There are ribbons available today. They were out at the front counter. Please take two, one for yourself and one for someone else that you know, that you may meet today or tomorrow. We need to spread this message to other men that we all know in our communities. As members of our community, we pledge to end domestic violence and sexual assault against women and all gender-based violence. So I want to just let you know that we have some wonderful people from our community, elected officials and others, who joined us today. We have a round of applause for each of them. We have our state representative, Jerry Cassidy. Jerry's in the back of the room. State Representative Michelle Dubois. Rodriguez, who's going to speak to us a little bit later today about these issues in the community. Sheriff Joe McDonald up here to the left. And then we have some staff members from District Attorney Tim Cruz's office as well. And he didn't sign in, but I know my friend Mark Lindy's in the back. He represents one of the local school committees. Just a little bit about how this impacts my work and my life before I introduce my good friend Liam Lowney. In my own personal life, after I went to law school, I met my amazing wife Suzanne. We both decided to become prosecutors. She was an assistant DA here in Plymouth County and I was in Norfolk County. We both spent over a decade in the courthouses working on domestic violence issues, drug issues, and other related violent crimes. It's something that's deeply personal to me and my family, and it's something that I go out of my way every day to make sure as Register of Probate that we do everything we can to address people who are going through ongoing domestic violence situations and are survivors of domestic violence. In the Plymouth County Probate and Family Court, we deal with many different issues. Some people vaguely understand what we do, but I'll give you a quick run through. We deal with divorces. We deal with people who are going through custody issues. We probate estates when somebody passes away. We do name changes. We do adoptions. One of the things that I'm most passionate about in my day-to-day work is our handling of domestic violence situations through restraining orders and protective orders. In Plymouth County, Massachusetts, even though we're probably about eighth in terms of our total caseload compared to other registries, we're second in the Commonwealth in the number of restraining orders that come through our offices and are handled by our four judges. That's over 900 restraining orders per year. We have wonderful safe plan advocates that we work with to make sure that when people come in and they need to address these issues, they're treated with respect and dignity, and we make sure we get them through the court system as quick as possible so that they can be safe with their family and have the legal protections that they need. So I'm deeply committed to this. I know all of you are. I want to take the time to introduce a very good friend of mine who is extremely committed to these issues. I'm going to pull up his printed resume, but as we talked earlier, I've known Liam for about 10 years, and as a point of personal privilege, we actually live in the same town. For 10 years, we lived on the same street. His two kids and my three kids are actually best friends. So we see each other all the time, and I know what kind of a man he is, a family man, husband, and a father to his two wonderful children. Professionally speaking, Liam began his career in victim services as a victim witness advocate in the Middlesex District Attorney's Office in 1998. As an advocate, he assisted victims of domestic and sexual violence and homicide with accessing services and the rights that they're entitled to in the criminal justice system. In 2007, Liam was appointed Chief of Victim and Witness Services by then Attorney General Martha Coakley, overseeing all aspects of crime victim policy development, service delivery, and the state's Victim Compensation and Assistance Program. Liam served as the Attorney General's designee to the Victim and Witness Assistance Board and the Human Trafficking Intra-Agency Task Force. In September of 2012, Liam was appointed by the Victim and Witness Assistance Board to lead the Massachusetts Office for Victim Assistance, commonly known as MOVA, as its executive director. He has led the agency's administration and oversight of federal funding for victim services, generated training and education programming, and developed responses for victims of crime. Liam led the agency response to the survivors of the Boston Marathon bombing and the administration of $8.3 million in federal anti-terrorism emergency assistance program funding. Throughout his career, he has advocated for policy changes that impact crime victims, including gun safety legislation, updates to the Victim Compensation and Assistance Statute. Liam, on a personal note, became passionate about these issues. In 1994, his sister Shannon Lowney was murdered while she was working at the Planned Parenthood Clinic in Brookline, Mass. Since that time, he has devoted his life as an advocate for individuals and families impacted by violence. He regularly trains professionals and seeks to empower survivors of crime. Let's have a round of applause for Liam.
Take a minute and thank Pat Kelleher and the team at FCR for putting this on. You know, it's community-based agencies where survivors are helped every day, but it's also community-based agencies that inspire change and prevention like we're doing here. So I appreciate the fact that you did it and pulled this together, and I appreciate the fact that you all got up early in the morning to be here, to be part of it. That's the first step moving forward. I want to thank my good friend Matt McDonough. Matt, as he noted, we've known each other for 10 years. Our kids play together. It's really great to know, as a resident of Plymouth County, that we have a register of probate that gets these issues. Anyone who's worked with survivors of domestic or sexual violence knows there's nothing more scary than the probate and family court. To have a registrar of that court in our county who's actually not only heard about domestic violence and maybe been to the right trainings, he's actually sat with them. And if you really want to learn about survivors of crime, survivors of domestic violence, you need to sit with them, hear from them, and learn from them. So thank you, Matt, professionally for the work you do. Thank you personally for your friendship. Matt and I are fathers of young 8-year-old girls. I also have an 8-year-old son. I'm an overachiever. I went for two. He went for the singleton. But we're both still walking upright. But I think both of us are committed to raising our daughters to be strong and independent young women. We're also committed to raising our sons to be strong and independent young men who understand the importance of having strong, independent women as their sisters. So my kids' names are Maeve and Will, and before I came here today, obviously I knew I was coming here today, but I woke them up as I normally do. That's my job, is waking up the 8-year-old kids during the school week. And it always amazes me, I'm sure you've had this experience, that kids don't get out of bed during the school week, but on the weekend, it's like 6 in the morning, they're poking you, asking for an electronic device, right? So I did that, and I've employed a new strategy recently, and I've said, you know, well, what really gets them going? What motivates them in the morning? And so my daughter Maeve, it's boogie music. So if I play some Cool in the Gang, she like starts wiggling out of bed, she gets up, and we dance together. And that's our new morning routine. I call it my exercise. It's all I do all day. But, you know, we do some Cool in the Gang, occasionally some Stevie Wonder. It's a great way to start the day. And as I look at her every morning, to, you know, dancing to the Cool in the Gang, I'm amazed that when I go to work, I know that there are women who have had very different experiences as they've grown up. But they used to wake up with the same hope and same promise that I see in Maeve every morning. And it's on that level that I think we need to be thinking, right? What happens between when they're 8 years old and they wake up with promise to later on in their lives when someone in their life, oftentimes a man, determines that physical violence against them is the way forward. Every victim is someone's daughter. Every victim is someone's sister and someone's mother. So as Matt noted, my journey on this path began 22 years ago when my sister Shannon was murdered. At that time, I was a 22-year-old kid. My biggest concern in life was whether I could pay for beer and rent, and which one was more the priority. I grew up a lot when I was 22, after Shannon's murder. Shannon, at the time, was 25 years old. She was working at Planned Parenthood in Brookline, Massachusetts, when a man walked in with a gun and killed her. Now, it's not domestic violence, it's not sexual violence, or stalking, or human trafficking, and some of the things we normally think about with violence against women. But I guarantee you that violence against a women's reproductive health clinic is very much violence against women. At 25, and I'll take my own point of personal privilege, whenever I talk about Shannon in death, I take a moment to talk about her in life. Far too often we define people by what happens to them and not by who they are. Shannon was 25 when she was killed, but she was a graduate of Boston College, much to my father, who was a Notre Dame grad's chagrin. She had a history degree. She had spent some time in Maine working with abused kids and went to Planned Parenthood as a Spanish speaker, very much with the purpose to ensure that women had access to reproductive health care. It was more than abortion, although that's the hot issue. It was about ensuring that women who had limited means could get the health care that they needed. That's why she showed up every day. More importantly, she was a sister and the middle child and very much the peacemaker in the family. Shannon had the same amount of promise. She was going to be a social worker when she was killed. And our world is less for her not being in it. But that started me on my personal journey of how do I make a change in the world? And the journey Matt read you my long, semi-long, self-aggrandizing bio. But I became a victim advocate. And I loved that job, and I loved that title, and I learned early on that it's more than an underpaid job, it's actually a way of thinking. It's recognizing that people, after being impacted by crime, need to be empowered. They need to be given tools and support so that they can take the next step forward. And that's the work that's done here at FCR, that's the work that's done in the DA's office, the advocate that works for the sheriff in Plymouth. That's what victim advocates do every day, whether at the parole board, whatever position they may hold. It's about taking someone after violence and giving them the tools so that they can move themselves forward. But victim services in and of itself is responsive. At the Massachusetts Office for Victim Assistance, it's an independent state agency. We are led by a board. The chair is our attorney general. We also have two district attorneys, currently Blodgett, DA Blodgett and Capeless. But we also have two survivors on our board, Josh Moulton, whose sister was murdered in 2009, as well as a woman named Danielle Sicard, who is a survivor of domestic violence. So it's great to be a survivor-led organization. At MOVA, our job is to make sure that community-based programs, local state programs, have the funding to do the work that they need. They have the training and education to do the work that they need, so that if a survivor walks into a program in Pittsfield, Massachusetts, Brockton, or Falmouth, they have access to professionals who have the same level of training and shared experience. And that's really our goal, is to empower crime victims, ensuring that they have access to equitable services across the state. We also work on policy. We talk to the legislator, and I'm so thrilled that we have some legislators here today who are committed to these issues. A few years ago, they passed a domestic violence law in the legislature that was pretty remarkable. Significant provisions on behalf of survivors of domestic violence. At the time, there were some provisions in it that we felt like, we've been advocating for several years, and had we gotten any one of them, we probably would have gone to a local place and celebrated the achievement. The fact that there were so many of them in one piece of legislation was pretty remarkable. So we're very grateful for that. But so we try to work on policy to make victims' lives better. But victim assistance and victim services is responsive. We're reacting to something that's already happened. We're accepting the fact that someone was a victim of violence, and we need to mitigate that in some way. We need to help them find housing. We need to help them get food. We need to help them find a new way and a safer way. What we're doing here today is not responsive or reactive. What we're doing here today is preventive. And what I'm asking you to do is, wherever you are in your journey, whether your journey like mine started 22 years ago, or whether your journey started this morning when you said, yeah, I'm going to this thing at 8:30 in the morning over in Brockton, whenever that journey began, I hope you're going forward knowing that it's to see a day where there is no more violence against women. There is no gender-based violence. We need to see that goal in front of us to keep working towards it. And men, this is not a women's issue. This is our issue. These are our daughters, our sisters, our mothers, our grandmothers, our friends. And the perpetrators are often our brothers, our fathers, our sons, our grandsons. And the only way we're going to make a difference is if we engage in the conversations that we need to have with them. And in this culture of so-called locker room talk, it's really important that we stand up and say, that's not funny. That's not appropriate. Women are not objects. They're not there for our amusement. They're part of our society. They're part of our lives. They're part of who we are in this race. And so it's incumbent upon us to make a difference. And walking away saying, I don't agree in, you know, hurting women, isn't enough. We need to be proactive. We need to speak out. That can take a lot of forms. Maybe you write a letter to your editor in your local paper. Maybe you engage in a conversation at your church. Maybe you just sit down at the dinner table and talk to your kid about what it means to be free from violence, what it means to make sure that the women in their lives are safe. So this is very much our issue, man. And so I'm thrilled to see so many of you, us, here. I'm thrilled to see so many of our female counterparts here. You move us forward and inspire us, but I truly believe that this is our responsibility. So thank you for taking the first step on this journey. I hope as you look at your daughters or your granddaughters or sisters' eyes, you see the same promise that I saw in Maeve's this morning. And I hope that we can work towards a day where Maeve or Kara Rose or whoever the young woman in your life is free from any sort of violence or ever feeling like they're less than. So thank you for the opportunity to talk to you today, and thank you for being here. Take care.
Liam, great job. Not only a very moving personal story, but it's great to have him as one of the leaders professionally across the Commonwealth on ending domestic violence issues. He did speak about dancing, and dancing is not only a tradition in his household, it's one in mine, and we're ending the St. Patrick's Day month, as we call it, in my household. My wife owns an Irish dancing school. Liam's children dance in the school. My daughters dance in the school. But I say this because I'm going to introduce a really good dancer. I didn't know that he was such a good dancer. He's already shaking his head and laughing. I didn't know he was such a good dancer. At the Brockton Senior Center last week, we had our annual singing and corned beef and cabbage, and while most of the attendees got up to sing probably very poorly a lot of Irish songs, there was a dancer in the midst, and our city councilor, Moses Rodriguez, man, can he cut a rug. That was impressive. So I'm very proud to introduce him as one of our guest speakers today. He's a city councilor who cares passionately and deeply about the city of Brockton and also about domestic violence issues, in particular, their impact upon ethnic communities. So he's going to share his thoughts today about how we can have an impact on these issues in communities that are very close to home here in Brockton. Councilor Rodriguez.
All right, man. You know what they say.
It comes around and goes around.
Actually, it wasn't, the dance wasn't all that good. I was dragged, you know, but I did the best I could to represent our city, you know. Thank you very much for having me here today. But before I begin, I just want to do a shout out to the folks that, I know you're called the FCR now, but you're still BFCR as far as I'm concerned. So, to be honest with you, I have no idea where this city would be without the efforts of BFCR. Because of the work that you do on a regular basis to keep our community safe, our folks educated, Pat, your staff deserves the greatest applause that we can give you, because without you, our city would not, I have no idea what we would be if it wasn't for FCR. So can we just give them a big applause? As Matt said, I'm a city councilor here in Brockton, but I've been in the city for 40 years. I've been married for 30 years, and Pat, I'm gonna, so that you don't have to say it, I'm gonna say it, to a saint wife for 30 years. It doesn't mean that I have not been put on timeout several times, but we've been married for 30 years. We have three wonderful daughters. So I feel passionate about women and protecting women. I come from a community that often is seen as a male-dominated community, with the Cape Verdean community. But it's also important for some of us in the limelight that comes out and speaks for on behalf of the women in our community. As Liam said, there are mothers, wives, daughters, friends of people, and it's important for all of us to do what we can to protect our partners. You know, I see my wife as my partner, equal partners. Actually, maybe not as equal. I think it's more like 60% her, 40% me, and then the other 10% back and forth of begging so I can get to around 50-50, you know. But we've been together for a long time, and we've had our bumps, because it's normal for people to have bumps on the road. But you know what? Above it all, we're friends. We're friends because, you know, think about it. If you're dating someone, I don't think you'll go up to a young lady or a young man nowadays and basically say, you know what, I why don't we get married, and I promise that we're gonna work together to build a home, we're gonna have some children, but once in a while I'm gonna beat you. And I don't think that partner would actually agree to those kinds of terms. So since we did not make those kinds of agreements in the beginning, I think it's important for us to share with our partners that that's not part of the plan once we sign the dotted line. So I think it's important, especially when you're dealing with folks that come from communities that are not as educated on community issues, that it's important for us that are out here to do our best to share those concerns with our folks. The Cape Verdean community it's no longer that way, and I'm glad that it's no longer that way, a male-dominated society. And I often blame the mothers, though, too, because the mothers tend to make their sons, because before we become husbands, we were somebody's sons as well. And often, you've got mothers empowering the little men to become men and macho men, you know? And sometimes we don't get that education in the sense in the home to teach the young men that as you're growing up, it's important for you to become real men, and real men do not put their hands on their spouses. So I'm not going to take too long, because you can come here and listen to me, because we've got a campaign year again, and a lot of us are running for re-election in the positions that we're in, so you're going to hear a lot about us selling our points throughout the community. But it's important to know that there are people within city government, within this community, who are defenders of women and will continue to defend them. That wasn't me. Okay. It had nothing to do with me. I know I get blamed for a lot of things, but that wasn't it. But just to know that there are a great deal of men in this community who are defenders of women. Not because we are, you know, like I come from a women-dominated, you know, household, but because I have a mother, I have a sister, I have cousins and aunts, and no longer a grandmother, but I had a grandmother who I loved dearly, and it was my life to make sure that the women in my life were protected. And I, as a city official, now make sure that the women in our community are protected, because we need to do this together. We need to talk about the issues. I mean, we all know that in the city of Brockton last year, we had two homicides. But those two homicides were homicides of domestic violence. They were not street homicides, two homicides of domestic violence. This year, we've already had one. You know, so it's a serious issue within our community. It's an issue that I implore people to talk about these issues. I empower people to come forward and discuss these issues. And I empower and ask all of us to come together as a community to make sure that we eradicate violence against women. There's no greater feeling to have a community where the women in our community, who are often the dads and the moms within the families, to be protected and to know that they live in a safe society, that they don't have to worry about somebody, you know, doing harm to them just because of their sex. You know, nobody asks to be born a certain way. I certainly would not, if I had a choice, I would not ask to have been born as poor as I am. You know, there's plenty of the Rockefellers out there and some of these other people. That's probably what I would have been, you know, to be able to do a lot more. But you know, we don't have a choice of how we come out. You know, it doesn't matter, you don't have a choice of whether or not you're gonna be born a man or a woman. So since you don't have that much of a choice, those of us that come out men, we need to stand up and make sure that we protect the women in our lives and the women in our community. And with that, I'm gonna close and just thank every single one of you for the work that you do, to continue to do the work, to continue to help us preach this sermon that we need to preach, that our community cannot stand idle while our women are being violated and our women are being murdered and beaten in our community, because that's not just the way we are. That's not the way we intend to do, and that's not the way this community is going to go forward. So thank you very much, and God bless you.
Thank you, Counselor. And I know the city of Brockton appreciates all the work you do on their behalf. Next up, we have Derek Hine. And Derek, I'll pull up his bio here, is going to help lead us in the pledge, with some assistance from a member of his Boys and Girls Club. He's the Chief Executive Officer of the Boys and Girls Club for the City of Brockton. He joined the club in the spring of 2015. Prior to his leadership in Brockton, he spent a decade with the YMCA movement in several South Coast communities. Derek's work and passion includes a focus on youth programming, child protection, and community development strategies. Derek graduated from Johnson & Wales University, where he studied business management and appeared in the TV Food Network series, Cooking School Stories. That's pretty unique. I like that. Derek is a selectman within his hometown of Swansea, and he serves on the board of two community nonprofits. Derek and his wife, Julie, have two young children, a daughter, Laura Lee, and a son, Landon. Derek, come on up here and join me.
Good morning, and thank you, Matt, for that kind introduction. I was asked to send my introduction in, and I didn't realize the whole thing would be read, but I do appreciate that, and thank you very much. I'd first like to begin by thanking Family and Community Resources for asking me to be part of today's event, and recognizing me as a leader in the community to end violence against women and all gender-based violence. I should say from the onset, I'm not an expert in this field. I'm not able to provide any magical solution as to the cause of domestic violence. Like many societal ills, there's no simple answers, either in understanding causes or solutions. What I can offer for consideration is a position to stand up for those who are affected, and a perspective of a career in social service agencies and as a husband and a father of two children. Throughout my career in the social service agencies and up to today, I've seen at least the secondhand and awful ramifications of violence within the home. I sadly see families torn apart by domestic violence, come to know children who are, have been assaulted themselves or seen it in their home, and particularly by their fathers. In this vicious circle, it's sometimes hard to imagine how we can do our part to really reverse the generational cycles that exist. For far too long, domestic violence has been characterized by its victims as a woman's or children's issue. And increasingly, I'm thrilled to see that there's recognition that domestic violence is primarily a men's issue. However, for me, the most fundamental change lies in the heart of the way men relate to one another. Men will stop abusing women and children when they start to appreciate one another. It's about having respect for each other as men. It's about recognizing that those who are different than themselves are just that, different. At the Boys and Girls Club of Brockton, we believe that we have the opportunity to become a catalyst in helping to curb violence and be part of the solution to mentor and promote the growth of young men. Our club offers a program known as Passport to Manhood. This program consists of 14 sessions, each concentrating on a specific aspect of character and manhood through highly interactive activities. Each club participant has his own passport, where he underscores the notion that he's on a personal journey of maturity and growth. Passport to Manhood represents a targeted effort to engage young boys in discussions and activities that reinforce character, leadership, and positive behavior. With me today are two young men who are currently enrolled in our Passport to Manhood program. I've asked them to accompany me this morning to share with what being a man means to them and help lead us in the pledge to end violence against women. Please help me welcome Odair Silvestri, an honor roll student at West Junior High and a member of the Boys and Girls Club's Keystone program. Odair has a vision to join the military and work in the medical field. And also Derek Rosefort, a freshman at Brockton High. He's an accomplished athlete and club volunteer. And Derek plans to attend college and enjoys giving back to others. Please welcome Odair and Derek.
Being a man means following your own path, not conforming to what society's expectations for men, but living instead life being the best person I can be. But being responsible for myself, my actions, and treating people with respect, no matter the real definition of a man. A man knows when to lead, when to follow, when to learn, when to teach, and most of all, when to stand up for a cause. Please stand up with us and repeat the White Ribbon Day pledge. I will promote respect, dignity, and equality.
Although you claim not to be an expert, it's quite clear that the programs that you're putting in place in the Boys and Girls Club are going to have a deep impact upon many young men like Derek and Odair. Let's have another round for these two young guys. So in closing, I just want to say a few things, and from my own perspective in the Probate and Family Court and as a volunteer in this movement, please, if you see something, say something. Get engaged, be proactive, spread the word. Take your ribbons with you and share them with people who ask them about them, and make sure that silence is never an option. Whether it's somebody telling a bad joke or you hear a story, be the resource that reaches out to somebody and say, you can do this different, you can think differently, you can act differently. That's how I look towards these issues on a daily basis, and I do that with my staff as well. So, in closing, I want to ask you to make your way over to the pledge table to sign the banner. We're going to be able to take photos as well. And with the pledge table, Sarah's raising her hand at the back of the room. Pledge table's right there. Please take the time to sign the pledge table, because this is going to be our banner to be able to show people you were here, and we're all committed on this journey together to making sure that we end domestic violence and violence against people of any gender. So thank you so much for being here today. On behalf of Family Community Resources and Massasoit Women's Center, have a great day. Thank you so much.